Hello everyone, how have you been doing? I'm so bored. How about you? I hope you are safe and healthy. I'm sad that I cannot see you guys in person, but I'm happy at the same time that I can use this high tech to deliver God's word to you. I pray that we'll be able to meet again in the chapel soon. Let's worship together through YouTube video clips. Please open your heart and sing the following two gospel songs aloud. If you do not know these songs, please feel free to listen to the singing and meditate on the lyrics.
In the rustling grass, I hear we walk in your ways, God. We receive your friendship with humility, gratitude. We could not stand without you.
Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Because of the novel COVID-19, we could not get together at the chapel for the last 2 weeks. I believe that all of us have never expected that we wouldn't be able to go to the chapel because of this kind of disease. The insert show us that the second reading, which is the today's text for my sermon, is Romans chapter 8, verses 6 to 11. I would say that we need to read from verse 1 to 17 of the same chapter to understand this whole paragraph for my sermon. So I would like to read Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 17, not only Romans chapter 8, verses 6 to 11.
Chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. And he led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, Prophesy over these bones, and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound, and behold, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are indeed cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, Behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. And I will bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. And I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. Psalm 130. A Song of Ascents. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities.
Chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die, but if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the Spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with Him in order that we may also be glorified with Him. Chapter 11. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped His feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to Him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, He said, This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when He heard that Lazarus was ill, He stayed 2 days longer in the place where He was. Then after this, He said to the disciples, Let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to Him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him. After saying these things, He said to them, Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to Him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him.
Do you have the freedom that God gave us? As verse 1 clearly says, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I would like to start with a little challenging question today. The Bible says that God does not condemn you and me. Then why do we blame ourselves and even condemn each other constantly? What do we consider more important? A word of God or church tradition? We could easily say we value the word of God more than a church tradition. But I think the reason why we condemn each other is that we have become accustomed to evaluating each other based on the church traditions we have learned through our church life for a long time. If so, what is the tradition of the church? After Jesus' resurrection and ascension, the Lord's disciples operated the church. From this point on, there occurred many trials and errors. As a result, diverse rules were formed and developed to obey the word of God properly and to distinguish the heresies out of the authentic churches. That is why we needed the Apostles' Creed. It was written about 300 years after the birth of Christ. The Apostles' Creed is called this not because it was produced by the apostles themselves, but because it contains a summary of their teachings. In addition to that, the rules of Jewish rabbis represented by the Talmud, which is the people of the early church were familiar with, were added to become the tradition of our church. The problem, however, was that for the Jews, the rules created by the rabbi was equal to or higher than the authority of God's word. So the word of God was treated as if it was inferior. I am not saying that the law is unconditionally bad and that faith is not unconditionally good. Jesus said many times that the law and faith must be balanced. Nevertheless, today's text speaks of the harmful influence of the law. If so, what is the problem? I would like to show you four examples that the unexpected wrong result will come if people follow a superficial point of view about the law instead of the essentials of the law. For those who concentrated their attention on the law only, number one, focus more on external and superficial things rather than go behind the outward form to grasp the inner meaning. The Pharisees and the scribes questioned Jesus because they did not know why they needed to do that. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands? Mark chapter 7 verse 5. While keeping your heart away from God, falsely respect him with your lips. Jesus said, and he said to them, well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, these people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Mark chapter 7 verse 6. Number 3. You prioritize or make equal the traditions that come from people alongside the word of God. When the Pharisees refused to follow God's commandments, Jesus said to them, he need not honor his father, so for the sake of your tradition, you have made void the word of God. Matthew chapter 15 verse 6. Number 4. Blame those who do not promote tradition. The Pharisees and the scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat. Matthew chapter 15 verse 2. How do you think about these verses? They showed us that they condemned those who violated the church tradition because they treated that the church tradition prevails over the word of God. As we see in verse 5 and afterwards, these thoughts indicate those of the followers of the flesh, and the result is death. If we listen to the word of God together and do not turn away from the thoughts and actions of the flesh, it is that we cannot become a person who pleases God as the words in verse 8. Clearly, verse 2 says, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. The law of the Spirit of life in Jesus has set us free, not by the observance of the church tradition, because the church tradition cannot be given priority over the Word of God. But then, why do we condemn others still? Why do we keep following the old and the wrong? Even though we are not becoming followers of the Spirit, thinking of the work of the Spirit and being members who pleases God. God has given us a great place of His glory. According to verse 14, it is written, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. In verse 15, he said, for you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. So So what can we who become his children call God? We can call for him Abba Father, because we are neither slaves anymore, nor have to fear God, because we are children of God. In fact, not only did God adopt us who are wicked sinners, and we do not dare call God my Father, but he allowed us to call him Dad, as a very friendly father, not as a difficult and scary father to call. That's why verse 17 says that we are now God's children and eligible heirs. Nevertheless, will you continue to complain and grumble at what is not God's word? We can't. We won't. I am a pastor of the Evangelical Free Church of Canada. I love the motto of my denomination, which is called Our Calling. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, charity. In all things, Jesus Christ. I would say that let's remember and follow the motto, even though you are not related to my denomination, because it is a generally right principle to apply to our faith. Let's not condemn each other unless someone makes a serious error related to God's salvation from now on. I bless you in the name of Jesus that you will encourage one another, share one another's burdens, strengthen one another, embrace one another, and love one another to become children of God, guided by the law of the Spirit of life. Let's worship together.
Splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great's our God, sing with me, how great's our God, and all will see how great, how great's our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead, three in one, Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the
Let's pray together. Number one, for those who are affected by the novel COVID-19. Number two, for those in government, may they be wise in their decisions. Number three, for our brothers and sisters who are serving this country, abroad or at home, by sea, by land, or in the air. Number four, and for anything else you want prayer for, let us pray.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stay safe and healthy. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Bye.